This has been a sort of lifelong story at Google for me. And I'd like to talk to you a bit today about how Google Geo and Google Maps got involved in crisis response. As Rachel said, I'm in charge of engineering for Google Maps, Earth, Street View, and many of the other geo products of Google. And I've been working at Google since 2004. So I was part of a company called Keyhole, which was a startup that did this zooming in 3D experience. And Google acquired us in 2004. But the big thing they could do is they could make the product free. So in June of 2005, Google Earth was released as a free product. And I think it changed a lot of things about the way people interact with geography and data. At the same time, a team inside Google was developing a product for the web called Google Maps, and I think many of you experienced with it. This is a very early version. As you can tell, it was incomplete, and we've done a lot more work since then to cover all the data. So the combination of the two tools gave us a suite of mapping tools, and surprisingly, just 2 months later, a natural disaster in New Orleans that preceded the oil one was Katrina. And this is a picture of New Orleans before the event, and this is after. This is the flooding, the dam breaking, you can see it there. What we learned was that maps become invalid during a disaster. The data, the landmarks, the places of interest, the roads, many of them disappear and are not findable. This picture here is an example. The helicopters were having trouble finding houses. People were calling in with cell phones that were still working and were trying to be rescued off of rooftops, but they couldn't actually navigate because the streets were gone. And so combining images like this with latitude, longitude coordinates from Google Earth, operators who answered the phone were able to tell helicopter pilots where they needed to go pick people up. And over the period of time, 4,000 people were saved using this technique, according to the U.S. government. They were very thankful of the help that we could provide with the tool. But there were many other things we learned about Katrina because we were basically just reactive to it. People were calling us. And technology did not save the day in this case, but technology helped first responders save the day. But what was missing was actually data and sharing of data. Google Earth is a sort of an interface for unifying data. You can take data from different providers and put it on top of each other, combining them and learning things. But in a lot of cases, U.S. government, big U.S. government agencies did not know how to communicate their data out to the public or even to other agencies within the U.S. government. And so they called us, and I was fielding calls from basically every major agency in the U.S. government asking for information or looking for ways to provide it. And Google Earth became a center point for organizing that, and that was true in several different areas, and you know, publishing storm information is probably the less interesting one. Finding the locations for evacuation and being able to identify where people were congregating and sharing that information with the Red Cross and so on was incredibly important, but there was no official process. And so that was one of the big lessons we learned, is that getting ahead of the game and having preparation was important. Google is, very focused on being able to provide a reliable service. In the case of Google Maps, we serve Google Maps from 8 data centers around the world. We have 99.995% uptime, and Google doesn't have scheduled downtime. So that's 26 minutes a year that somewhere in the world Google Maps might not be available. And this has been true for the 7 years that it's been up. But the ability to always have this service available means that we can reliably provide it. We actually test our own disaster response internally. Just this year, we went through an entire exercise where we basically disconnected Mountain View, California, the headquarters, from the rest of Google and made sure that all the services could stay up. We learned a lot about any dependencies, remaining dependencies we had, but none of you noticed because Google stayed up. But we do this every year, practicing to figure out how we can make Google more reliable. And having this service up, one of the things we learned is that the internet is sometimes one of the first services to come up after a disaster because it is actually reasonably robust across the data, wireless, and so forth services. But this led us to formalize our crisis response. We created a Google Crisis Response team based on a lot of the people who had participated in Katrina. And they set up this landing page and a set of tools based on what we'd learned. And the first place we applied it was in Haiti. So this is a picture of Haiti, Port-au-Prince, before the earthquake. And one of the things we do at Google is try to get imagery as quickly as possible out of post-disaster events. And so this was a satellite image taken very soon after that was used to help discover where people were congregating, what buildings were still up, and help to organize our response overall. Responders use these maps to, you know, choose medevac locations. We also had a large contingent of mappers use a product called Google MapMaker to create, you know, reliable roadmaps of Haiti where there hadn't been before. In Katrina, we had seen a lot of sort of ad hoc services to find people, creating lists, you know, having websites with, you know, lists of names, trying to explain where they were, where they'd been found, or that they were missing, and could somebody please help. In Haiti, we actually were able to formalize this, and using a standardized data format, combine that with third parties, have a website where we had a people finder launch 72 hours after the event, and got up to 55,000 records from the earthquake in Haiti. And this helped people find loved ones, connect with who was missing, and, you know, helped really organize the world's information in this very particular way. So we had a suite of tools after Haiti, you know, Person Finder, custom Google Maps, Earth, and so we continued to organize this and improve it. And this helped us really prepare for what was, I think, the biggest disaster we've responded to ever, and certainly recently. This is a picture of Sendai before. And again, using quick publishing of satellite imagery, we were able to get updated images. And this was used to see where the damage really was, because I think we didn't have videos, you know, available to fully grasp the magnitude of the damage. But being able to quickly look at satellite imagery and see the magnitude of the devastation, it's not just these anecdotes, but actually the breadth of the coverage really changed people's minds about what was going on. So, when the earthquake hit, we had an office in Tokyo that immediately dropped everything and organized into this team that was focused entirely on responding to the disaster. But they weren't alone. We had people in Mountain View, a whole team, and teams across all of Google offices working on this project. You know, we have the imagery teams and all the crisis response teams coming together to respond. And this time, because we had had the practice and developed Person Finder previously, we were able to get Person Finder up within 2 hours of the earthquake, and this made all the difference. Here you can see the landing page customized for Japanese, and also we enabled it for mobile phones that were, you know, extraordinarily popular in Japan, both the web interface and the WAP phones, allowing more people to communicate with the service. But again, this wasn't just about one website and asking people to upload. We worked with everybody, all websites around the country, and also with volunteers, because one of the things that we discovered is that this is not just an online problem. At relief centers all throughout Japan, people were making lists. I am here. These people are missing. And they were writing it up on boards. We had volunteers take photographs, over 10,000 photographs taken, which were uploaded into a Picasa album, where we used other volunteers to transcribe these names and enter them into the Person Finder. This was responsible for 140,000 of the records that we had in Person Finder, and gave it a much more complete story of who was missing and who was being looked for. And I think it shows the combination of both offline and online, and how we continue to have to do this bridge, because you can't depend on just one technology to solve the problem. Another challenge in Sendai and in Japan was drivability. Roads were down, you know, boats were blocking, you know, important highways. We partnered with Honda and others to get probes of driving information to discover where people were not driving, and presumed that perhaps because the cars weren't making it, that there was something seriously wrong there. And we were able to provide reasonably up-to-date maps of serious down areas in roads around Japan. Street view. You know, as soon as we could, after the disaster, we actually put our street view cars back on the road in Sendai to take after pictures, because we had before. This is an image that we'd had from street view taken 1 or 2 years before the event. And this is an image of the exact same place after. So going from before to after. We put up a website called Memories for the Future that allows you to compare for all the places we had before imagery, the after imagery, and it's used by displaced citizens to see their houses, see what they look like, see what it looks like now. It's also used by researchers to sort of quantify the damage over time and be able to look at all of the houses, which ones survived, which ones did not. So what's next? We need to build better tools. We had a very good set that's been improved with the events of Haiti and Sendai, but we saw way back in Katrina that there's several things that need to be done, and we've improved in that area, but not completely. People come to Google in a time of disaster. This is a graph of the search term tsunami in Japanese, and you can see that there was some earlier events that had significant spikes, but that people more and more are coming to Google to look to see if there's information, and we should direct them to the best organized information for the disaster at hand. Having a landing page that describes all the information that we know and pointers to all of the great providers of this information, I think, is critical. But getting good information is very hard. We've partnered with private agencies to get better information about Japanese electrical, Japanese telephone, and again, the road data to have updated information in times of Japanese disaster. But there is much more. As I said with the Katrina issue, communicating with the government, getting government data, being able to publish data out is really, I think, the biggest issue. And so having openness, being willing to share data, figuring out ways ahead of time to share data so that it can be used by everyone is really part of it. Having the right data format so that you can share it using open standards. We have one called KML, but there are many others. Just being able to publish it out there so others can download it is part of the problem. But another one that's really important is license. There's very important data, but there's restrictions, either because the government has rules about how you can use the data, or in some cases because it's private data and we don't have a license. We need as much data as possible available with an open license, so in times of emergency, it can be disseminated very widely, very quickly, because license is actually one of the biggest friction points. So look to your own data, look to your own methods of sharing, and make sure that you can get that data out quickly in time of disaster, but do it ahead of time so that we have this and are ready for it. I think that's really what we should be talking about today, is how to get this data out ahead of the next disaster, because preparing for the next one, I think, is the most important thing we can do. So we've done a lot at Google for crisis response in the mapping area, but there are many other aspects of data that we'll be able to talk about today, and I'd like to encourage you to come up with new ways of sharing data and working together, government, business, nonprofit, so we can have together the best response possible for disasters. So with that, I'd like to turn it back over to John and continue on with the event. Thank you very much.